The areas that 3D rendering can really help is, first of all, improving the product's marketability. Secondly, it allows engineers and product owners to get a proper understanding of the product's form throughout the design process. You'll actually understand what the thing looks like without having to make a physical prototype. And third, because you get these tools as part of the process, you can create marketing content along the way. You can be selling that product even before you've made it. A new process these days really should be industrial design first. In our experience, trying to satisfy the function that's required from a product and then creating form, so create some blender models, which are just solid models that we push and pull around and we mold them like clay, make them look organic, make them look really nice and saleable, and then from there, take those products and put them into CAD, where the engineers can do the engineering to make it manufacturable. The way we used to do things, you know, previously was we would basically just jump straight into CAD. From there, you kind of end up wrestling with a CAD machine that kind of allows you to do all sorts of crazy things that may not be required just to create something that's, you know, shaped in a certain way. So Lender gives more freedom to people who know how to use it, like Nicole. Nicole is an amazing artist, especially with vector art, things like that, but where she's really shone now is this 3D modeling using Blender. This system here that Nicole's showing now was for a client of ours, Hydrogen. We had been given a brief on what the product needed to be. The device could have literally been a box with a removable battery. We knew we wanted it to be anodized CNC'd aluminium. One of the major requirements that we wanted for this particular product was to protect the antennas. So the antennas are quite large because the device needs to work in quite a rugged environment. It's going to be working in steel machines, which impedes the RF, and the large antenna helps us basically get the best Bluetooth connection back to the tablet as possible. We came up with an idea to have these ribs, and Nicole went through a process where we started off with basically the simplest design, which would provide the function that we needed, but the form was probably less organic or less marketable per se. And then we incrementally iterated across the different designs, and we made those changes in Blender without doing any CAD to figure out what the customer wanted. The customer wanted the most extreme looking one, which is awesome. And then we took that Blender model and put it into SOLIDWORKS. This was a handheld emergency stop device using long-range RF for autonomous trucks. Catherine, Nicole and myself came up with some hand sketches of roughly the size and shape we would like to functionally have something work. We wanted a hole for a belt loop. It had to be big enough to basically have a battery that would last a certain amount of time. So we did some engineering to be able to figure out how big that battery might be. We then knew that we wanted a button that was going to be the emergency stop that had to be covered. So that's kind of that lid on that side there. And then we wanted some other inputs as well. So we wanted to be able to turn the thing on and off. We have our liquid silicon rubber flaps that we use on the cranio. So we wanted to be able to recharge it by having a USB plug. And then we set Nicole to work. What do you usually do here, Nicole? You basically copy and paste and change as you go.
Just duplicate and iterate and try different sizes and spacing. And for this one, since we had like a good idea of like what kind of shape we wanted, and then it was just a case of, do we want this to be smaller or larger?
Yeah,
or
yeah.
Where do you want the buttons to be? Do we want a singular button or a round button or a square button? Or where do we want the little LED lights to be? Which areas can we actually fit stuff in?
Yeah, yeah. So this was a combination of myself going really hard on in CAD and then giving feedback to Nicole. Okay, what about if we change this? What about we change that shape? We were doing sort of a hybrid approach where we would be in CAD and in Blender at the same time, but Blender was primarily used to kind of figure out what would look nice to the end user, what was functional for the end user. This is a good way of doing things to explore things quickly and a really good interface between engineers and designers is probably key to getting good use out of the tools and getting quick wins, I guess. If you've got a pre-existing CAD model, we can basically bring it directly from CAD format directly into Blender, and then we would basically texture it.
Normally I'd get the CAD model in,
yep,
and it would be no textures at all, and then I just make sure each of the individual bits are sort of separate from each other.
Yep, yep.
or go into them individually and highlight different parts to do specific textures, and then making sure that all the bits don't have any holes in them or missing any pieces.
Yep. Do you have a specific CAD format that is easiest to use, or?
Usually we convert them to OBJ files.
Okay.
So we can open them in Blender easily.
So we've created a library of textures that we basically then can apply to any product. You're also using a renderer or shader that gives us photorealism as well.
Yep. Using cycles and render engine.
These are some textures that we've created for the Cranio product suite. Is that right?
Mm-hmm.
Cranio is anodized aluminium. It's got a plastic, I think it's an acetyl CNC machine plastic top, which one day will plastic injection mold. This here is emulating a anodized aluminium look. We've got some for rubbers, for silicones, for plastics. This is a sand texture. Oh wow, look at the little tiny little grains.
Yeah.
So what do? You actually throw the sand on there, let it drop or something.
It's actually a displaced texture. It comes out from the plane. And on top of it, I've used geometry nodes to disperse a whole lot of grains on top of it to give it a more realistic texture.
Yeah, nice.
Without having to go overboard with physics.
So you've actually emulated a backdrop, is that right?
Yeah.
So you've emulated a backdrop and then you've positioned a camera. You've given the camera specific focal point and features, and then you're placing in lights, is that right?
Yeah.
That's a pretty cool environment. Did you make that?
I got assets and placed them into the scene.
So you're physically putting in like sticks and twigs and dirt and grass and stuff, which is awesome. The more simplistic way you can do it is basically bring in it's called a backplate. You bring an environment in and it's like a big spherical picture. You place your cameras towards your 3D model. You drop that 3D model in space, say onto a floor or whatever. You can have different lights, so like the sun or other bits and pieces that come as part of the environment as well. So this is one of the reasons why we would want to use something like Blender over SOLIDWORKS Visualize and things like that. SOLIDWORKS Visualize may not be able to handle the level of complexity that's involved in these things, because you know, some of those leaves and things like that, they're actually little modeled up little pieces that in a CAD program could be very heavy. So this sort of program handles it much better. You can create blockbuster movies in this software. So there's no reason why you can't use it for your product development as well. Special effects is the cool stuff, the new stuff we're getting into. What is this one doing? It's melting.
Animated texture and melting metal.
So it's actually creating a model, heating that model, and almost emulating the realistic elements. So in finite element analysis, we bring in a mesh of 3D elements and then we put stress on it. This here is kind of doing that. It's creating a mesh and then applying some physics to it, and then all the elements sort of move on each other. So this is the stuff that I tried to play around with years and years ago, but I never really got my teeth stuck into. When you're doing sort of things like this, which is obviously for marketing material for some of our customers and their industrial products, we want to be able to show people what a product may go through or what it's capable of. So we can do things like dust, we can create smoke, we can create fire, we can do water simulation. It's not fluid dynamics, it's not 100% accurate to what the fluid might do in real life, but it's close. It's got a lot of mathematics in there that have been derived from real world properties, but just with rendering and camera dynamics overlaid on it to make beautiful visuals.
Like dust in the air.
Oh, nice, yeah. Dust particles, yeah. Imperfections on the surface of things really make a difference to photorealism, because, you know, when you see a render without any of those things in it, it looks fake. So you can apply those as part of the texture. There you go. So we can see there some scratches and things like that. We expect these Cranio devices to be used and abused out in the mine sites and oil and gas, put up on poles or run around in trucks or, you know, in a production plant. So when we're creating marketing content, we really want to be able to emulate what this thing looks like in the real world, what it might look like in the real world. The major advantage of that is we're getting marketing content out before we've even made one. So we've got a few golden devices here. We literally have one device with all the seals in it. The seals aren't tinted yet. It doesn't look like a real one. We don't have the fascias on there. We're not ready to take that to market. So these visuals that we can create from 3D rendering technology can allow us to get marketing content out way, way earlier than actually having a physical product. It also allows us to refine the design, refine the form, fit and function before we have even made one. So virtual prototyping is absolute number one, of course. What's this here? Snow. Some foam or something?
Snow.
Cool.
That was an add-on, real snow. And that also comes with the snow texture as well.
Yeah,
and cool. When it renders, it's extra detailed than it is currently in the viewport.
So Blender, again, being open source, there's people that create add-ins and you can basically just download them from a massive library, snap them in and use the GUI to configure what you need. Yeah, amazingly powerful. It's the way of the future. I tried to do this back in the day with Blender and I got like really bad water droplets that sat on a Cranio top hat, original design that I had. It was untextured or partially textured and I managed to get like water that would like flow and then go down to all the little holes and stuff. But now you've actually taken it and gone to the next level. Are they like little water droplets you've put on there? Physical water droplets, and then you've textured them?
Yeah, with a water texture.
How did you put them on there?
There was a geometry node that I used to scatter them on top of the actual object. So with this, I could change how much it actually shows up on it.
Now you're doing like maths and coding and stuff, just with a visual GUI. The other content we can create from this would be animations, that marketing content on the way something works. So if you're trying, especially with a lot of the complex products that we work on, a lot of the time it's very hard to get across how the thing works or why it does that thing. It's not a hard thing to do. It just takes a lot of effort to set it up to look nice and
put in time.
Yeah, time and love, I would say, is the inputs for an animation, but the output can be a really good understanding of what the product's going to do for the customer. This is the Busmin logo.
It's a graphic for the Busmin website.
Yeah, because Busmin means busyness minimized. So we're trying to get rid of the busy work inside a business. And my version of being busy less was having a martini on a beach. So this became sort of like the ad hoc logo for Busmin for a while. So how have you created this? I've never seen this style before.
It's a 3D model with a texture that allows it to look more like a 2D image. A toon shader, I believe.
Toon, as in cartoon?
Yeah, toon
cool.
Shader.
Blender just gives you so many possibilities to make interesting marketing material. This is the stuff that I only dreamed of. So my background is in tire design. That's what I did my thesis on. Magna Tires was one of the two first companies that employed us, Element Engineering, as a service provider. Yeah, we basically created 3D models used for marketing content only for Magna back in 2010. And we were using SOLIDWORKS PhotoView. And then we knew that we wanted to use Blender. We knew the capabilities of Blender. And Nicole's really taken it to the next level now where we're basically bringing those 3D models in. We're texturing them with all these textures that we keep improving. Are you applying like dust and things like that, or is it just one texture that is algorithmically driven?
One texture.
Yeah.
And then I adjust it for each of the tires, bar any special requests that we get from them.
Tire rubber, especially some of these larger tires, is quite hard to emulate the texture itself. Sometimes it can be really shiny, sometimes it can be textury. So like if you zoom in on one of those lugs, see the texture that pops out there? That's the texture that looks very similar to real life. But sometimes from certain flat sections, you get this really real sheen come off it, which you can obviously see there, which Nicole's really unwell with. And these stripe sections, is that a texture as well, or are they physical?
Those are physical ones.
Yeah, so that's a pretty detailed texture. Each one of those nodes is basically trying to do a different thing, and it's using an algorithm or using mathematics, basically, to pick out. So that part is trying to pick out the outside, I guess. That part's trying to pick out the whole surface. That's picking out just the outside curvature or the extremes. So do you tweak the numbers?
Yeah.
Yeah, cool.
Whether or not it's flat on the edge or round.
We've created something like over 100 different CAD models now, but the marketing material is the main one we do for them. best case scenario is that the engineers and the industrial designers are all working as one. And so that's what we're really trying to achieve here. So using these rendering technologies through the process is, I think, key to differentiating a good product from a really good product. And it can really help. I think probably the biggest thing is boosting sales, number one. The product looks as good as it performs. Secondly, it draws the eye in. It may actually attract users that may not have been attracted before from if it was, you know, more boxy or more simplistic. And it may allow you to explore and allow the design team to explore options that would take time and effort, more time and effort to do in CAD. So Nicole's much better at being able to create different shapes and things. We might hand sketch something out. The design thinking is a lot different to the engineering thinking as well. Engineering thinking, you might be distracted by, oh, well, that's got to be this thickness because of this. We can allow a bit more freedom in these surfacing tools to be able to create different forms that then would have a better impact on the product at the end of the day. Oh, that is awesome.
Show this one.
That is so awesome.
Neon sign version of our logo.
And the texture on the wall and everything. Who wouldn't want this on the website?